All right, everybody, we're going to get started. Thank you all for coming out. Leah Garces is the U.S. Director for Compassion in World Farming and on the Board of Directors of Global Animal Partnership, one of only three third-party animal welfare auditing systems in the United States. Leah's organization focuses primarily on corporate partnerships, a collaboration with food businesses and making real and practical improvements for farm animals, particularly poultry. With an expertise in broiler welfare, Leah provides strategic and technical advice to food businesses to advance policies and practices that result in measurable improvements for farm animals. Compassion in World Farming has forged partnerships with many food corporations that have committed to improve the welfare of their animals. Here is Leah now to speak about this progress.
Oh. All right, is this on?
Yep.
It's on? Hello? Can you hear me? No? Yes? Mic is on. Yeah?
Yep.
Okay, good. All right. We're good? Yeah? Okay. Hi, everyone. I first of all want to thank you all for being here. I know it's been a long week, and you're all exhausted, I've just heard, apparently, from being inundated with all of these things that you could do for farmed animals and circus animals and lab animals and all the animals that are affected by human beings. So I'm grateful that you're still willing to be here and think about another thing. I'm also super grateful to Chris for bringing me here. I'm very, very honored to have the opportunity to speak to you today. As mentioned, my name is Leah. I'm the Executive Director of Compassion in World Farming. So little background, we were started in England in 1967 by a dairy farmer. We're very unusual in that sense. So this dairy farmer, his name is Peter Roberts, he was really upset with how the industry was going. This was post-World War II, and you know, industrial agriculture had really taken off, and they told him, you either get big or you get out. And he said, I don't want either one of those options. So he started with his wife, Anna Roberts. They started like making leaflets with their daughters in their kitchen. And that grew and grew. And one of the first big things that was achieved was the Treaty of Amsterdam, which is sort of the cornerstone of EU law, which recognized farmed animals as sentient beings. And this changed the landscape in Europe of what was possible. And from that, lots of legislation became possible. And Compassion in World Farming was behind all of that. So we banned cages and crates throughout the countries of Europe, which at the time was smaller. But then if anybody wanted to get into Europe, they also had to ban cages and crates. Then we hit a roadblock. We hit the roadblock that we hit was the EU getting bigger. It went now to become 27 countries. Soon that's going to be a little bit less with Brexit. Never mind. However, legislation became really hard to pass. We found that with the new countries coming in and a bigger conversation happening, and some of those countries where legislation was less developed, it became very difficult to get anything new passed. We actually have something coming up for the first time in a long time, which is banning cages for rabbits, which is coming up in the next couple of weeks in Europe. And it's the first piece of legislation like that on confinement that we've done in a long time in Europe. But around the time that the EU started to expand, we decided we gotta pick another strategy because things are moving too slow and too many farm animals are suffering. So we started with corporate engagement. In around the end of the 90s, early 2000, we started to see what would happen if we worked with companies. And we found we really hit on something. So I want to talk about our corporate strategy and where we're at and why it's working, and why we're making more progress than we've ever made before in the history of farm animal protection, in the history of animal protection. So here we are, freaking out politically throughout the country, right? So even if you're a Democrat or you're a Republican, we're all stressed out. This is a political climate that is making us having a lot of anxiety as a country. So the American Psychological Association, they do these surveys, and they said this is the most stressed out we've ever been as a nation, ever, no matter what side of the spectrum you are on. And there's a good reason to be, and there's things that are affecting animals. The Endangered Species Act is endangered. And the USDA has removed information about violators of Animal Welfare Act. That's scary stuff. But here's the question for you, the most number of animals used in this country are farmed animals. So how is all this affecting her? It's not right now. It's not. And in fact, between November and now, we have got commitments to help more farmed animals than we ever have in history. We are at a place that is very exciting because we have hit on a strategy, we have hit on a way to make progress that is new, it's innovative, and it's fast. And it doesn't matter what's going on politically, we're plowing ahead. So I want to talk about that. And the first thing to understand is, how does a company work, right? A company, the first thing to understand is a company is under a lot of pressure. They work quarter to quarter. Their goals are quarter to quarter. Whereas, you know, in an election, the person representing you is working election to election. The CEOs are working quarter to quarter. They're under pressure from consumers who are saying, I can go anywhere I want to eat my burger or my chicken. I don't have to just go to you. You can't say like to your representative, like, I don't like you, I'm gonna go to my other representative. There's not that pressure, right? They're also under pressure from competitors in that sense. So you can go to McDonald's and say, if you don't do what I want, I'm going to Burger King. And if suddenly a bunch of people go to Burger King because of how they're treating animals, that has a big impact. And finally, they're under pressure from their shareholders and investors for the same reason. And we have packaged animal welfare as two things. Animal welfare can either be a ginormous risk to your company or a ginormous advantage. Which one do you want it to be? And so let's take this, right? What is the risk for a company in this? Does anybody want to offer what they think a risk might be for a company?
Bad PR.
Bad PR, really bad PR. If you have an undercover investigation that comes out and it shows that you're treating animals like this, who's going to want to eat eggs from this, right? And recently we had a company who we were talking with them, and we heard them say, okay, at first we started thinking about how much is it going to cost us to go to cage-free? But then we flipped that coin and we said, how much is it going to cost us to not do that? And we have hit a pivoting point here where it costs companies more to not do better for farm animals than to continue with treating them badly. And that's because of consumer awareness, consumer pressure. No one wants to accept animals in cages. Nobody wants food from animals that have been treated cruelly. Just nobody, unless you're a sociopath. There's just nobody. And we started to take this show on the road, this idea. And what do you notice about the dates here? Do you see the dates on there? They're all within a month of each other. Right? The first one that came out was Aramark in March. And we didn't know this going in. This is kind of retrospectively looking back. But going in, we were, you know, had our feelers out. And this is the entire movement from HSUS to the Humane League to Mercy for Animals to every group out there, animal equality, all of us working, thinking, all of us had our feelers out to these companies trying to get them to switch to cage-free. And then Aramark goes cage-free, and within a month, their two competitors go cage-free. And these three companies constitute 90% of the entire food service industry. So within these three, we had the whole food service industry agree to go cage-free. So we took that on the road, and we started going again, got our feelers out, and we're asking which companies will agree to this. We're thinking about all the pressures. There's campaigns running. There's pressure from the outside. We're going to their investors. We're talking to them on the inside. And then we have our big first breakthrough. Really big breakthrough. And it was a surprise to us all. But you know, the most important thing was this one message, which was consumers will never accept cages for hens. We're not going to give up. We're not going to stop. So it's not a matter of if, but when. And we had this happen. This was the biggest shift in the cage-free campaigning that happened. Because once we got this happen, once we got McDonald's to go cage-free, And you know, they agreed to this. They said this is the future. They already had their European McDonald's had already agreed to go cage-free. They had other countries. In fact, in the UK, they're free range on their eggs. So it made sense. And then we were able to take this to every restaurant in the country and say, if McDonald's is doing it on their Dollar Saver menu, why aren't you? And then consumers started to ask that question. And then that question became, how much is it going to cost you not to do this, to fall behind, to look? And this becomes more of a risk then, not just a risk from the bad PR in terms of what it looks like, but you're not following market trends, and your investors are going to start getting concerned. You're not on top of this. You're not where the market is at. You're not with consumers anymore. So what are you doing in business? And we had virtually the entire restaurant sector fall within a six-month period and agree with this as well. And everyone kept saying, OK, it's fine for food service. It's fine for restaurants. But grocery stores are never going to go. Because we like choice, right? We go to the supermarket, and why shouldn't we have, fine, you want cage-free eggs? We'll offer it. But we'll also offer battery cage, and we'll offer pasture-raised and free-range. Like, people should have choice. And this article was put out in December of 2015. And we said, I don't think so. I don't think anybody wants cruelly produced eggs. And we started, as a movement, we started a campaign that lasted for months against Costco. And sure enough, Costco agreed to go cage-free. This then, again, created that ability to go to all their competitors and say, why aren't you cage-free? And one after the other, they went cage-free. Not all easily, I will tell you. And I want to show you what we had to do to get Trader Joe's to go cage-free.
Just click on Explore. It should be
okay. All right. So my colleague Nina is in the room. She's shaking her head at me. She's very mad now. But she's the star of this and the kind of brains behind this.
Yes, this is Compassion and World Farming calling. Thank you.
Hello, it's me.
I'm not singing, by the way.
I was wondering if after all these years you'd go cage-free. Let's go over your policy. There's a change.org petition. So far, you're not responding. Trader Joe's, can you hear me? I'm in California dreaming about hens who flap their wings. There's so many companies with their plans in place to let the chickens out and set them free. There's such a difference between eggs from caged and cage-free hens. Hello from the other side. I must have clucked a thousand times to tell you it's time to let the hens fly. They're still caged and I can't figure out why. Cluck, cluck from the
So that was some fun we had.
Hello?
Okay.
It's me.
All right, well, keep watching Adele spoofs. It's really an addictive rabbit hole you could go down, I can tell you. Just click that.
Yeah.
Okay. Okay, so we had a lot of fun with that. We had launched a petition, and we have somebody on our team who we call Detective Dreskin, and she's basically a stalker, like a professional. She's really good, not a stalker, she's not really, that, I didn't mean that. She's very good at never giving up. And she's very polite, she's a mom, and she's like, you know, just really cares about getting farm animals to do, for companies to do the right thing for farm animals, and she was calling and calling Trader Joe's, and they were not responding. We launched a change.org petition, we got over 100,000 signatures within 10 days, they were still not responding. So we basically did that video over the weekend with like our kids and our friends and like the local like school farm. And we launched it on Wednesday, and by Friday, 6 p.m., we got the call from Trader Joe's going, please, please, like, can you stop that video? Because we sent it to their staff, and it turned out, you know, their staff were like, what? Like, why aren't we? And it was a time when the Adele video was very popular, and there were lots of spoofs going on. So it worked. So not every company agreed very easily. We kept going down the list, and this was the game changer in the grocery store sector. When Walmart agreed, and it was definitely not easy to get them to agree, but they did, then it became like the McDonald's situation where we said, if Walmart's doing it, why isn't everybody doing it? Doesn't mean everybody still agreed to that. And this was the very last, just happened in July, the very last of the top 25 grocery retailers to go cage-free, and it took another kind of fierce effort of petition signatures. And HSUS also did a great at some ads and stuff around that. It was, again, kind of a movement-wide effort. Again, these are our, we delivered 110,000 petitions to their headquarters because the new CEO started. So it's a great opportunity for us to do that. And very soon, by the end of the summer, this past summer, we had over 200 companies, essentially the entire market, committing to go cage-free by 2025. Some of them sooner, 2020, but phenomenal. Never globally had we seen this kind of progress. And it really woke everybody up. It really shook us, because we, you know, when you're trying different things, it was like we were scientists experimenting, and we had tried lots of stuff that had failed. And then we hit on the experiment that worked. So we had to bottle that and figure out what did we do that worked so well. And we started to see, just to point out, it's not, even though these commitments are in the future, it's changing today. So already we see the flock sizes of cage-free going up. These are real changes happening right now. So what is it that happened? So we hit food service. When we reflected on what happened, it was food service as a whole. And when we got one leader, the rest also felt the need to follow. And that's makes sense, because if one of them is ahead in the market, they're going to get market advantages. Investors are going to question. I mean, it makes the market shift together. And then we had these two come after, so that one by one, they all agreed. And this spread not outside of our borders, which is where we really started to see the impact we could have. So although the UK and the EU had banned battery cages, they still had enriched cages, which are basically fancier cages, but still cages. And this had not been tackled. And through the progress we had made here in the United States, they then began to question, what in the world are we doing? The UK has fallen behind the United States on animal welfare? How could that be? When I first moved back here, I lived in England for 10 years. I used to say, oh, the US is 20 years behind. I don't say that anymore. I say we are leading. We are the ones changing the scene and pushing what is possible. And we see that here. So the top UK supermarkets, the 10 top UK supermarkets followed our lead. And now we see this happening globally. We have global commitments happening. So Compass, for example, is a global company, and they made a global commitment to go cage-free. And so did Aramark, General Mills, and some others. And then we see it happening in Brazil. We have a bunch of companies in Brazil and Mexico going cage-free as well. So the ripple effect goes beyond our borders. And that's very exciting to think about the impact. As a country, we lead in business, in the business sense. And as a country, therefore, we can lead on animal welfare through our businesses. But now there is the giant, huge elephant chicken in the room, which is the broiler chicken, right? So, you know, laying hens, their suffering is unbelievable. Therefore, the whole time they're in this cage, they can't move, they can't turn, they can't flap their wings, they're on wire. It's horrific, horrific. So their individual suffering is horrific, but their numbers are far smaller. Broilers constitute 95% of all factory farmed animals in this country. So 9 billion are raised and killed every year. That's 23 million chickens are killed each day, and 269 per second, year round. It's just a concept that's hard to get your head around, the number of animals that are moving through our system. So if we really want to have an impact on the numbers of animals and therefore the hours of suffering that farmed animals are enduring, we have to hit this one. And when it comes to farmed animals, the part we have to really think about is what is their suffering? Their suffering is their bodies. They are born to suffer. They are bred to grow so fast, so large, they can't walk properly. They can't breathe properly. Their whole purpose is for their breast, because that's what we like to eat. It's our favorite part of American meat, and so the whole industry has focused on making the breast meat huge. But they didn't think about the unintended consequences of the rest of that body not being able to service that breast. So their heart, their lungs, their legs, their bones, the rest of it can't keep up. But who cares, because they only live for 47 days, so all we have to do is keep them alive for 47 days. Still, millions, I mean, that's not acceptable, by the way, but also, they're not even living for 47 days. The industry thinks it's great that they have a 5% mortality rate. 5% of 9 billion animals is a lot, and why can't you keep all of them alive for 47 days? That's how bad it is. And even the ones that are staying alive are suffering, they're in chronic pain. They live in chronic pain, and that's not okay. They're in terrible circumstances. They're living on their own feces, on litter, on a regular basis, which means they have breast blisters, they have foot pad blisters, they have all kinds of problems. They have dirty air, hard to breathe, etc. I won't gross you out. You already ate lunch, so luckily we have tofu here today. But the main focus of our work had to be, we have to breed a better breed of bird. That's complex. We went to companies before and said, can you just let them out of their cages? Cage or no cage? Binary ask. Now we're saying, breed a better breed of bird, and can you give them natural light, more space, better litter, and can you slaughter them more humanely too? That's complex. But what I've learned in this business is you have to be comfortable being uncomfortable. And you have to push for more than you thought was possible. And we found out companies were capable of doing way more than we ever thought they were. And I'm going to go through that. So this is not my best friend, as you can imagine, the Animal Ag Alliance, Hannah. Even they were saying growth targets are going to be the next activist target. This is just demonstrating in 1925, a bird would take 112 days to get to slaughter weight. And today, they only take 47. That's how much faster they're growing. It's insane. And these are the kinds of conditions they live in. Totally overcrowded, unable to breathe, panting, etc. OK, first big breakthrough. For years, we had been working on something called the Global Animal Partnership, which is, I'm on the board, I'm the chair of the board. We've been working on a certification that would fix what was going wrong with broilers. And you know, even Whole Foods hadn't agreed to this yet, right? So we had a very concerted effort. So GAP, Global Animal Partnership, is made up of farmers and purveyors and animal advocates, and we worked together on a new standard, and Whole Foods agreed to it. And it meant they were agreeing by 2024 to a slower breed of bird, more space, better environments, and the whole package that we thought wasn't possible. And when they passed that in December last year, I thought, this is great. This is the beginning. I saw what was going to happen. Suddenly, we had a feasible road to go down. And then something else surprising happened. We have been working with Purdue for years, and we had put out an investigation condemning them. We worked with a whistleblower factory farmer who exposed that their label claim was wrong. They had been sued by COK and HSUS for misleading labeling on humanely raised. And they did something phenomenal, which is say, you're right, we were wrong, and we're going to fix it. And they came out with an animal care policy, which started to address, not fully, and they have a long road to go down, and time will tell what it means for the birds. But they said things like, we're going to put natural light in houses. We're going to test that. We're going to test and look at slower growing breeds of bird. We're going to look at more space and enrichment and play. They committed to, believe it or not, they committed to doubling in 3 years the play that birds have, that play, you know, play activity in birds, which meant that they had to do something to make them want to play, from putting in playground type things like enrichment or lighting or things like that. These two things signaled to us we were ready to reapply the egg campaign. A major, they're the fourth largest chicken company in the country, and also Whole Foods was saying, we're a commercial entity, a grocery store, and we're committing to this. It's possible, right? But it was pretty crazy for us to think, like, can we get the whole market to agree to a Whole Foods standard? We're like, yeah, we can. We're going to do that. And we went out, and that's what we did, and we're doing right now. And we probably, we're right now, we're here in the process. So, and I think in about 6 months, we're going to be there. And very soon after that, all of them will fall down. There's only one way this is going to go. We already had, this happened in November. So while we were all kind of reeling about election results and feeling totally lost, this was happening too. We didn't get any media about any of this because it was pretty hard to get media, you know, in this, the last few months has been pretty hard. But this is 60 million animals per year are affected by this agreement. Compass agreed to follow the Global Animal Partnership standards, which meant 100% by 2024 of their chickens throughout their entire stores, they service, I think they're here as well. They're one of your food service providers, but they're in hospitals and cafeterias and colleges throughout the country. They agreed to this. And guess what happened? Within 1 hour, 1 hour of them was Aramark coming out, right? 1 hour. They actually put out, and it was simply because their system, one system was slower than the other, so they both put out a press release that said, we are the first food service industry. And we had each of them writing to us, who's going to tell them they're not the first? And we're like, well, one of them, you can see the hour is first, so yeah. And within a month, we had Center Plate, Delaware North, and you can see from our beautiful little pie here that basically that's the whole food service industry. That's 100 million animals in about a 6 week period, right? That is phenomenal. There are 250 million laying hens in our entire country per year. This was these companies doing 100 million. It's fantastic, fantastic, unbelievable progress in such a quick time. And we went on. So Panera was the first national company to commit to the exact same thing as Aramark and the rest of them, following all the things that we had agreed. And we are now, this week, I think we had Quiznos the week before, and Abba Payne. I don't remember, there's so many coming in, when exactly they're coming in. But throughout the movement, we're working really hard now on this. And I say throughout the movement because it really is. We also learn something else. Like, there are many different groups that work in this country on this issue. And we don't agree on our tactics. Some are more aggressive, as my organization's more of a collaborative one where we work with companies, hand-holding them, writing their policies. We negotiate their policies with them. And then there's other organizations that are doing the more aggressive campaigning from the outside. But companies were telling us, like, can you please all ask us the same thing? And we're like, sure, we will. And I don't know if they really wanted us to do that, but we all got on the same page. And these are the main organizations in the country here. And actually, Compassion Over Killing signed as well onto this. So they're missing. This was a slightly older version. And we all agreed to these same standards. So no matter who's sitting in front of a company, we're all saying the same thing. So it's not like they can go to somebody else and say, will you give me credit for doing half of this? Nobody's going to say that now, because we all got on the same page on this. Now, as law students, I'm sure you're really concerned about compliance, right? How is this going to play out? How are we going to keep them to these commitments? These are just like media blitz, right? Like, they just get us out of their hair. Well, no. So we learned something from eggs, which we are going to go back and fix, but we learned something for broilers, which is this. So I'm almost done. These red highlighted parts were essential new parts of the negotiations that we were doing with companies. This is Chipotle's agreement, but everything, every company looks like this. There are three parts, which is they're going to have to, if they're not using GAP, so GAP has a third-party auditing program. So if you're certified by GAP, there's third-party coming in and checking you're doing what you said you were going to do, and that's how you get the certification, which is, and FSIS approves that. Now, the second one that we're saying, you have to do 100% by a date. We will not, and the date is 2024, and nobody can go beyond that. So 100% by the date. And the third was annual reporting. Transparency and reporting are critical. So each year, a company has to report on where they're at on their this 100% that they're supposed to get to by 2024. Now, this is something we're coming out with in a couple of weeks. So my team doesn't even know I'm going to show this. But this is what we're planning to do for eggs. So we want to track where companies are at. In a couple of weeks, we'll be launching a new website called Egg Track, and we will be tracking companies along their commitment. And this will automatically create pressure to their investors, to the public, to say, if you're not disclosing that, that's really bad. I don't believe you. I don't trust you. Or if you're like 2% when you should be 10 or 25, that's also really bad. I don't believe you're going to get there, and I'm not happy. There's a lot of pressure that could be applied through this tool, but it's also for companies to pace themselves, to know, oh man, I didn't even think about that. I need to get there. I need to pace myself in the market. This is where the market's at. This is where I should be at. So the next time, so I'm going to skip this, but the next time somebody has a freak out moment with you politically, and they're really having a crisis, and they're having, the world is a terrible place, and everything's falling apart, and I don't understand my country, please tell them this. We are winning. We are at a moment where it is possible that every hen is going to be let out of her cage. No, it's not possible. It is going to happen. Every hen is going to be let out of her cage very soon, globally, because of the work we're doing in this country. And every broiler chicken is going to be living in better conditions and not be given bad genetics that lead to a life of suffering. That is going to happen. And who knows what we're capable of after that? Fish is the next thing on the horizon. Who knows what we're going to do? But I'm very excited. So please, the next time somebody has a political freakout moment, tell them we're winning. We rule. That's it from me. I'd love to take some questions. We have about 15 minutes.
And if we could use the microphone for questions, too.
Does anyone have any questions from the audience? Because I have a question.
Okay.
And my question is, just how do you start the conversation with like Whole Foods or Walmart or whatever?
Yeah.
It seems like they wouldn't be super open to listening from you.
Well, I don't think that's necessarily true. Actually, I think that every company now, the hard work has been done. Animal welfare matters in the market now. We had to work for decades to even make that something that mattered to companies. So that hard work is done, and every company who deals with animals has somebody in charge of animal welfare now. Now, they may not know how to do it, and it's probably somebody who has no training in it at all. And when you go to them, our approach is to say, this is something that matters to your consumers, to your investors, your competitors are doing it. We're here to help you. That's our approach, Compassionate World Farming's approach. You need to get on this. It's happening, and you're going to fall behind, and it's a risk. That's how we approach it. But other organizations will say, you know, we're going to mess you up, basically, or something like that. They're going to have an aggressive campaign coming. But all those pressures matter, you know, all those pressures together jointly matter.
Hi, thank you for that. Just a question, I guess, about prices. Mm-hmm. Do they expect prices to go up in, for eggs and animal-related products? And if so, how would it affect, I guess, poor people? And would there be, I guess on the one hand, maybe it's a good thing. Maybe people will think, oh, animal-related products are more expensive, so we can eat more vegetables. But on the other hand, there might be pushback.
Yeah, we, of course, always get that question. Now, the first thing we say to companies is, how much is it going to cost you not to do this? You're going to lose your market share. You're going to lose your edge in the market. This is what people want. And I think it's really wrong for us to assume that people with low income don't want food that comes from a place that animals aren't abused. It's not right. It's not a privilege to get products where animals aren't abused. That's not a privilege. It shouldn't be just only privileged people get to have not abused animal food. That should be for everybody. And we pitch that quite often, saying, this is your job to make it affordable. You need to make sure when you're wheeling and dealing, and that could be Walmart or McDonald's, they have the power because they have the market share to negotiate that. And as volume increases on the demand for a product like cage-free, the price goes down. As that becomes the norm, the price goes down. There will be a cost increase. But also my answer to that is, sure, free labor was a lot cheaper than paid labor. But we switched. We had to. It's not ethical to produce animals like this, and we have to move in the right direction.
Sorry, just a follow-up. I guess also, is it possible that they might say, well, since it costs us more to raise animals, that we might give lower wages for workers, that we have to cut the cost somewhere?
No, we've never had that happen. What we have had discussions around is reduction of meat products, meat, dairy, and eggs, which I think is a really, that's real. So our pitch is do better and less. So replace, so we think that animal that has a life worth living is going to be something worth, is more likely to be something that's more nutritious. And we've just done a study, for example, how chicken products today are much higher in fat. They have something called white striping, which you can see in the supermarket. I don't know if you've ever seen that, that striping on the chicken breast. And I think there's something to be said about that. But I think that when we talk to restaurants and everywhere, the millennial diet, like the demand is changing, and it means a lot less meat. So it's about shifting with that, too. I think our ask to make things, to make products, to make animals live in a better life will mean, yes, we need to consume less. We definitely need to consume less. But that's more sustainable, it's healthier, and it's the direction of the market anyway.
Does anyone else have any questions?
Okay.
Just on the price thing, during the Yes on Three campaign here in Massachusetts, there was a woman who testified at the hearing at the State House, and she was poor and was on the food stamps in the WIC program, and the WIC program required her to buy the cheapest product available, and there was ones that are marked WIC that are approved for purchase, and it did that based on the cheapest, and so she didn't want to buy. She wanted to buy the more humane product, but she was prevented from doing so just because she was poor, because they were both available. Whereas if there was only cage-free eggs available, she'd be able to, you know, purchase according to her conscience. So that was something I hadn't heard before.
Thank you. Dan, did you have a...
I actually had the same question.
I guess when you do discuss prices with these companies, do you have your own economist who has his own projections or anything like that?
Yeah. So we have worked with an agriculture economist and has looked at the prediction of what that can be. But it's very hard to make that prediction because market forces will change the price over time. So where we saw cage-free eggs at first, them saying it'll be 25 cents more, they now predict it'll be like 10 cents more because as volume goes up, price goes down. So, you know, I think we try to not pin that down. Mm-hmm. We've broken down the ask for broilers, and so we know which parts are the most expensive and the least. So like going over to controlled atmosphere stunning, which is what all companies are signing up to, it's nothing. It costs nothing over time. And enrichment costs nothing. The thing that costs is giving them more space and the different breed because they're going to live longer. So we know which parts cost more. We know which parts they're going to be resistant to. But pinning it down, I don't think it's a good avenue to go down because the shift in the market is going to affect that. And at the end of the day, if you don't have a consumer that wants to buy it, who cares what the price is? People don't want to buy battery-caged eggs.
No, that definitely makes sense. I have friends who will want to buy more humanely raised meat or eggs, but don't because it's more expensive. But I've also heard that it's more expensive not because it actually costs more to produce, but actually because the companies that are producing are taking advantage of people who want more humanely raised animal products.
I know there is markup, and in the UK there was a big expose about, and we haven't, it'd be interesting to look at here, about the markup that happens on free-range, pasture-raised, et cetera, eggs. And there was a big expose on supermarkets in the UK about them marking up those products to make a premium. Mm-hmm. So definitely there's something there.
That definitely makes sense. Okay. Anyone else have a question?
Hi.
Hi.
Thank you for being here. That was a great presentation. So obviously factory farming is a very big issue in this country. So I'm curious as to, obviously with the amount of production that's happening and how this switch is going to be going from more humane, like, and putting factory farms out of business, hopefully, where is it that a lot of these, you know, producers or companies that are going to be providing these humane practices, like, are they going to be, you know, next to where the factory farms are? Is it a completely different part of the country? Or, and my other question has to do with how did the date, like the 2025 come up as far as when they're going to make the change?
Yeah, so I'll start with the last one. The 2025 is easy. We called the, when we were working with Global Animal Partnership, we called the breeding companies, the main breeding companies, and asked them what kind of time frame would they need to build up the parent stock, to switch over the breeds, to get up to volume. And they said 5 to 8 years. And so we pitched it at 8 to make sure it was feasible. I regret that. I wish we had gone for 5. I feel like it could have been. And so, you know, we're learning all the time about, you know, it's like just data we're gathering. So maybe the next thing we'll go for, we'll push for an even harder date. What are those farmers doing? We're working with two farm companies right now. So Shenandoah Valley Organic and Crystal Lake. And they are, one is a pasture-raised system, and the other one is organic. They're both GAP rated, so one's GAP 3, one's GAP 4. And they have a waiting list of 50 farmers who want to switch from factory farming over to working with them. And we have a great film, which maybe I'll send some stuff to Chris afterwards, but of working with Ivana Lynch. I don't know if you know who she is, but she was Luna Lovegood in Harry Potter. So we went out to Arkansas and we converted an old chicken house where the guy had been raising for a main chicken company and decided he wanted to do it different. We like sawed a hole in the side of the door and kicked it open, and it was really fun. And she like tried to make perches, but that's not her talent, we'll say. She almost like drilled her hand at some point. But so that's one option where we're trying to connect farmers that want to get out to farms going forward. There's something we need to do about that aspect, though. And I mean, people who know me know that I'm like obsessed with this thought of, and I say this because, you know, I was in North Carolina recently and I was driving with my family and my kids were like, what's that? And I was like, oh, that's where they used to dry tobacco. And they're like, what's tobacco? I'm like, oh, people used to smoke, and because they never see anybody smoking, you know. And people used to smoke, and they used to dry tobacco, and that was the barns for, you know. And it was so cool. We're like driving through saying, like, this is something that was bad and is of the past, and there's like the remnants of it. And in my head, one day we'll drive down the countryside and go, my grandkids will ask, what's that? You know, grandma? And I'll be like, oh, that's the chicken houses and that kind of thing. And, you know, we have to figure out those people in those parts of the country when they want, and many, many, many of them do not want to do this anymore. They're trapped in debt. They're basically indentured servants. And as lawyers, I would like really, really encourage you to look into contracts around factory farms and trying to stop new factory farms from coming up and figuring out alternatives that those people can do. And it's a problem we need to solve for sure.
I just want to say thank you so much for coming out. A bunch of students are going to have class at 1, so I think we'll wrap up now. Just can everyone please give a round of applause? Thank you so much. And will you be around for a couple of minutes if people want to come up and talk?
Okay. Happy to chat. And eat my food now that I don't have to worry about spilling it on myself and all that.